Paul records these words in the first letter to the Thessalonians in chapter 2. You yourselves know, brothers and sisters, that our coming to you was not in vain, but though we had already suffered and been shamefully mistreated at Philippi, as you know, we had courage in our God to declare to you the gospel of God in spite of great opposition. For our appeal does not spring from deceit or impure motives or trickery, but just as we have been approved by God to be entrusted with the message of the gospel, even so we speak, not to please mortals, but to please God who tests our hearts. As you know, and as God is our witness, we never came with words of flattery or with the pretext of greed, nor did we seek praise from mortals, whether from you or from others, though we might have made demands as apostles of Christ. But we were gentle among you, like a nurse tenderly caring for her own children. So deeply do we care for you that we are determined to share with you not only the gospel of God, but also our own selves, because you have become very dear to us. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Would you join me in prayer? Oh, Lord, we do thank you that you are a fortress and a mighty God in our lives. We ask that you'd continue to speak as you already have in the service. Give us ears to hear and hearts that would be courageous to follow you wherever it is you're calling us to stay. For it is in your good name we pray. Amen and amen. Thanks so much again for being with us. It's wonderful, absolutely wonderful, and adds so much. So thanks for this morning. And second sermon, it's a little different. It's not as good as yours, just same the second time, but we'll do our best. I don't know about you, but when I see leaves, I think of winter. What about you? Yes? Yeah. Or I think about my neighbor two doors from me that's got the big tree that never rakes their yard. And so when the south wind blows, I'm just going to get this off my chest because I feel like I need to. The south wind blows, it assembles in my yard. I pick them up. And then for a moment, I think, would it be Christian just to take this? I mean, why leave them for the garbage guys? They don't deserve that kind of stuff. Just go back up the street and he'd never notice. What do you think? Yes? No? All right, I'm seeing more nods of yes than I am not. You are my kind of people for sure. Yeah. The book of Thessalonians is the first or the oldest recorded letter from Paul that we have. It was at the low point of his apostling ministry. He had some problems apostling. You know what apostling is? You sing about it in a couple weeks. Here we go apostling across the field so green. Is he looking at me? Okay, I'm not going to turn back the service. It was apostling. It means you take the message of Christ. And it didn't get better the second time? Okay, you're welcome. Apostle is someone who takes the gospel of Jesus Christ across to a new culture. And Paul had been doing that pretty religiously, you know, no pun intended. And he has reached a low point in his ministry. He's in Philippi. Things are going really well until jealousy became apparent and kind of raised to the top of the attention of religious leaders. And they actually imprisoned him and then ran him out of Philippi. And they said all sorts of terrible things about him. So what does he do? He goes to Thessalonica, which is the northern Greece. It'd be the capital of Macedonia at the time. And he begins the ministry again. And he has exactly 3 Sabbaths, 3 weeks, until the folks in Philippi that wanted him gone arrive and follow him to Thessalonica. Like, can't you just leave me alone? I've left where you are. Why are you following me here? And they begin to sow the same seeds of dissension. Say the same things about Paul. He can't be trusted. He's just out to get your money. He's no apostle of God. He's just a shyster. He's a fraud. And Paul spends exactly 3 weeks until he's run out of there. And he goes on to Berea. And it's at this low point of his ministry that he writes this letter. And what does he say? You know as well as I do that my time with you was not spent in vain. Whoa. If anything was in vain, it had been those 3 weeks that you got run out of town again. Wasn't that just the low point of your ministry? And yet Paul does a different math. He's got a different scorecard of what he knows God desires. Arthur C. Brooks is a Harvard professor. And get this, he's a Harvard professor of happiness. How do you get that job? I want that job. I wonder if UK would hire me to be a professor of happiness. I mean, that would just be awesome. But he's a professor of happiness. He's written several books. One book, Strength to Strength, he tells of a story of him flying on a plane. I don't get out in the world enough. Everything good happens when you're flying on a plane. So he's flying on a plane, and he hears a conversation behind him. Now, nice people would call this eavesdropping, but, you know, we've never done that. I'm sure you've eavesdropped. But he hears this couple behind him that he's like, I think it's an older couple. And they're having this conversation, and he picks up on a couple of sentences that stops him short. The wife is telling the husband, no, it wouldn't be better if you were dead. That piqued his interest. No, it wouldn't be better if you were dead. A few minutes goes by. He hears her tell her husband, trying to support him, of course you're still needed. Of course you're still needed. And Arthur Brooks, in his mind, is painting a picture of these individuals and of the man in particular. And what he paints the picture of is someone who had great aspirations, great dreams, and they just never did come true. Someone who wanted to go do great things and yet never seemed to get it all worked out. And in his mind and in his heart, that's what he's thinking is going on behind, is someone who really wanted to live a life that was out there and influential and powerful and just never pulled it off. He's feeling bad about it. Now, as planes do, it lands and they disembark. Arthur Brooks says he stands up, he turns around, expecting to see this couple and this man in particular. He had the image in his head. He says, I turned around and I could not believe what I saw. I knew this man. And not only did I know this man, most of the world knows this man. He's one of the most influential people of the past generation. He has done more good than most people will ever even dream of. He says, and to complete the story, this man and his wife are making their way off the plane. The pilot comes out of the cockpit, stands at the door to shake his hand and says, I have so wanted to meet you. You have made a huge difference in my life, and thank you for everything that you have done. I aspire to be like you. Now here, just a few minutes ago, this man is telling his wife, it'd be better off if I just no longer had breath in my lungs. It's like I'm not even needed anymore. My life has been lived in vain. For naught. And yet we know by all outward measures, his life had been abundantly successful. So why is he having this response when the Apostle Paul, in his low point, when things weren't going well, said, I know my life hasn't been in vain. My time with you, those short 3 weeks, weren't in vain. Well, what is the difference between these two individuals? I've just been thinking about it all week long. And I want to be, maybe you do too, more like Paul. That regardless what happens in my life, regardless of the fruit or the not the fruit, that I can be say at the end of it or at the end of a season, my life was not in vain. There was meaning and purpose behind it. Now, I dare say that is on the hearts of all of us, whether we are beginning this journey or whether we are nearing the conclusion of it, whether we're in season or out of season. We want our lives to mean something, right? For it to make a difference. Amen. Yeah. Thankfully, our Christian faith speaks deeply about how to live a life that doesn't end in vanity. It speaks deeply about how we live a life that is meaningful and impactful, regardless of the outward circumstances. And the Apostle Paul gets us on this track. And I want to read verses 3-8 to get this in our hearts and our minds, and mine as well. Hear the Apostle Paul again. In the depths of his, things are not going well. 3 weeks with this place. He says this, "For our appeal does not spring from deceit or impure motives or trickery, but just as we have been approved by God to be entrusted with the message of the gospel, even so we speak, not to please mortals, but to please God who tests our heart. As you know, and as God is our witness, we never came with words of flattery or with a pretext for greed. Nor did we seek praise from mortals, whether from you or from others, though we might have made demands as apostles of Christ. But we were gentle among you, like a nurse tenderly caring for her own children. So deeply do we care for you that we are determined to share with you not only the gospel of God, but also ourselves, because you have become very dear to us." Apostle Paul says, you want to live a life that you can say was not in vain, not for naught. Focus on your relationships. Those are the key. Relationships. That's why he says, it's with gentleness we were with you. I don't know about you, but I've been hearing this word gentleness over and over the last few months as we've been studying Paul. What about this word he continually comes back to and is so important for our relationships? Maybe gentleness can best be understood as giving another person space to be who God's created them to be, a child of God, a person of infinite worth, and giving them the space to live their life and be supportive and encouraged. And as we're gentle with one another, our relationships grow and they deepen. But he says, not only that, it's integrity. Integrity is key to relationships. Who you are when no one is looking actually matters. That's what our Christian faith says and what Paul says. We were the same with you in and out of season, and it made a huge difference. It has often been said, those who die with the most toys win. Have you heard that expression? That's a lie. And you know it is. Those who die with the deepest relationships, they win. We want our life to be lived free and full of meaning. It is about those relationships in our lives. Arthur Brooks talks about two types of friends that we all have: deal friends and real friends. Now, you can't help it. We all have deal friends. We all have people that we're around, and it's more transactional in nature. But that's okay. But we can't stop there. We need some real friends in our lives, too, that aren't there just because what we could do for them or what they can do for us. But they're there because they actually love us and have our best interest at heart. Real friends are the ones that will tell us the hard truth, even when it's not convenient. Real friends are the ones that hold us to a higher standard and don't judge us when we don't reach it, but encourage us all in the process. We need real friends, and not hundreds, a handful. If we want to live a life that is free of vanity and full of purpose, who are your real friends? And let me just say this, no matter where you are in life, more towards the beginning or more towards the end, it is not too late to pour into those relationships and create real ones. It takes time, patience, and it takes forgiveness, for no relationship exists for any length of time without some forgiveness. Paul also knew that chasing vain glory was a sure way to end life in vanity. vainglory. Rebecca DeYoung writes a book, The Seven Glittering Vices. I would encourage you to read that book. Such a profound and modern way of getting into the seven deadly sins. And in it, she talks about vainglory. And I'm going to use her words because they are so profound about vainglory. She says this: pride is often confused with vainglory, but pride is the desire for genuine status. Vainglory is a desire for recognition and acclaim. To be more precise, vainglory is the excessive and disordered desire for recognition and approval from others. It is seeking after the applause of the many to make ourselves feel good about ourselves. We put others' appreciation of us at the center of our lives and feel better when we get it and worse when we don't. We're on a path to meaninglessness. Others cannot ever fill that void in our lives. We chase after approval. We chase after all those things that are seemingly the world says are what we are to chase after. We end up finding that they are incredibly unfulfilling and at worst, destructive. You know, Jesus said in Matthew 6 that if we practice our faith so that to be noticed by others, we'll get some reward in this life, but there won't be in the next. I think that's what vainglory is all about, is putting others and their approval of us at the very center. And when our self-worth is dependent upon someone else thinking good about us, that's a recipe for disaster. Can I just be probably way more honest than you want me to be? My self-worth ebbs and flows based on your response to my sermons. How honest is that? I feel better when someone comes out the door and says, good sermon. Go figure. Jim Stratton, beloved. Many of you know Jim Stratton. He served as senior pastor here in the late 80s. Dear friend to so many of us. Jim Stratton told me a story once that has stuck with me. He said, I was in the Pikeville church and I preached an amazing sermon. And I'm at the back door about to greet and I'm just so like, this was great. I probably saved the whole universe today. He said, a man comes out the back door. He said, preacher, that was a great sermon. And Jim's like, and then the man said, but the devil probably already told you that. Yikes. Any time we put the approval of others as the value to our life, we're heading towards vanity. You know what we need to do instead? Continually remind ourselves we're a child of God. That it's not what we do, it's who we are that makes all the difference in the world. Paul knew that. That's why he said, we didn't say things to please you or to anyone else. We said things they were true and God wanted us to say, and it made all the difference. You liking us or not liking us did not at all impact our self-worth. May it be with us as well. May it be with me in particular. Finally, Paul teaches us that to live a life full of meaning is to embrace testing. Embrace testing. All right, good luck with that. All right, honest. Who wakes up in the mornings like, Lord, please test me today? Raise your hand high. Oh, yeah. Here's my prayer, because I know I should pray it. Lord, please test me. Not so much though. You know I'm pretty weak. And yet it's embracing of the testing of the opposition. That's what Paul says. We preach the good news in face of great opposition and testing. And we continue to move forward even when everything seemed to not be going our way. Because he knew embracing of testing and of failure and opposition was a sure way to build our character, to develop Christ-like character in our lives that was going to pay dividends forever. How we approach testing and suffering even will make all the difference in our lives long term. How we ever bought into the lie that ease and comfort was the way forward instead of embracing testing, acknowledging that some days are just, we're not going to get it all figured out. And what can we learn from that and how can we move on? Here's one thing I'll encourage you to do, because I'm doing it too. What if we had a testing or failure journal that we started keeping? Hang in there with me. So you have a day, didn't go as you had hoped, had some disappointments, maybe just flat out fell on your face, and you write it in a journal. Here's what happened this day. You go to your phone and you set a reminder. You know how to do that? I don't. I have to ask my kids. But you set a reminder for 30 days out. In 30 days, the reminder says, what are the three things that you learned from that failure on that day? And you write those down. You set another reminder 6 months out. This time the question is, how did God work to bring good from a difficult situation? How did you see God work? It'll completely transform how we see our testing and our opposition, even our failure. It'll begin to be opportunities to see how God is going to work to form us and shape our characters in way. We are not going to escape difficulties in this life. We're all testimony to that. Amen? But it's what we do with them that makes all the difference in the world. It's the difference between sitting on a plane wondering whether life is even worth it, or saying with confidence, my life has meaning, regardless of what the outside world says. I've been thinking, what would I say to this man and his wife that if I'd been on that plane? Well, who's kidding? I wouldn't say anything to them. Just not in my nature. But what would I think? How would I dress? Think I would remind this man that he is a child of God. He's a person of infinite worth. And that his life is more than what he did. It's the relationships that he made. It's that person sitting right next to him, sharing words of encouragement. And then I think I'd remind him to not buy into all the things that the world says that our life needs to be about. Look, we can have a meaningful life and never get written about in the history books. We can have a meaningful life without having some legacy that everyone knows, because we can develop deep relationships. We can put the glory to God. We can embrace the difficult days in our lives, knowing it's shaping us into the character of Christ that will carry us for eternity. No life lived with faith in Christ can ever be lived in vain. May that be the hope in our heart, because that is the reality of it. Father God, thank you that you are the one who says what is valid and what is good. And I pray that you would assure us that your Son, our Savior, the one in whom we have faith, is guiding us forward. Lord, it is you that makes life meaningful, not our accomplishments or our successes. And we give you thanks for your unwavering faithfulness in our lives. And it's in your name we pray. Amen.